For science.
Hi, I'm Neil deGrasse Tyson, and this is Rising Stars. Today, we're featuring Emily Graslie, who's the chief curiosity correspondent at the Field Museum in Chicago. She also has one of the most popular science YouTube channels called The Brain Scoop. And we've got her right here. Emily, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Yeah. Good to be here. You're actually like corn-fed from somewhere.
Oh, yeah.
Free-range farm girl.
Yeah, Rapid City, South Dakota. And my family has ranch land near Faith, which is where Sue the T-Rex was found.
I remember Sue.
Yeah.
Yeah, Sue was up for auction. Were you touched by that?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Really?
My great-great-grandfather and my grandfather, they had a shed on the property where when they were checking on the cows and checking on the pastures, they'd find a fossil and they'd put it in the shed.
You had your own museum.
Yeah, he donated it to like the little town of Faith, South Dakota. And so their appreciation for fossils was something I grew up with.
So, but our crack team of researchers alerted me that that's not what you majored in though.
No, I didn't. I studied art.
Art?
Mm-hmm.
What kind of art?
Landscape painting. It was a way for me to take my appreciation for natural environments and share it in a medium that I was good at. I wasn't good at science, but I was good at visuals.
Now, of course, there's a very storied relationship between artists and naturalists.
Mm-hmm.
In the day, you didn't have a record of what you saw or analyzed unless there was an artist who could capture it for you.
Right.
So you guys were like walking hand in hand for centuries.
Yeah.
But now you just carry a camera. So is there still a role for artistically minded people?
Oh, yeah.
In natural history and environment? Because as you know, though I'm director of the Hayden Planetarium, we are part of the American Museum of Natural History. So I have some sort of osmotic sensitivity to what you're immersed in.
Well, because scientists are communicators of the natural world, but in a very, I wouldn't say formulaic, but in a way that doesn't always reach general populace. And artists are a way of bringing that science and translating it into a different medium. And so I think the idea that art and science are these two different things is just doing a disservice to both. You know, they're best when you combine those efforts. You know, what I was trying to do, I started volunteering in this natural history museum on my campus as an artist. I wanted to draw the collection. And
what campus was that?
University of Montana.
Montana,
mm-hmm.
Right.
But the more I did that, the more I wanted to show what was happening in the museum.
So where I'm standing right now is what we refer to as the sheep room, because the majority of the things in here are sheep.
As I understand it, you came to widest attention with a wolf.
Yeah.
I love me a good necropsy.
I'm very excited.
Roadkill wolves have to be some of the rarest things out there.
Well, and the only reason we knew that to collect that one is it had been radio collared. And so Montana Fish, Wildlife, and Parks calls me up and they're like, hey, you're the volunteer at this museum. We have this roadkill wolf. Will you come pick it up? And I was like, yeah, can I put it on YouTube? She was like, I guess so. And so we documented the process.
Okay, so what's the process?
They put it in a deep freeze for a few weeks to supposedly kill off all parasites. But then when we brought it back to our lab and let it thaw on the table, fleas started jumping out of the fur.
Whoa, hey, where'd this guy come from?
No, that's right.
Fleas, are those fleas? Sick.
These are badass fleas.
Yeah.
Man.
Resilient.
Right.
Will to live.
Right. So you were bitten by wolf fleas.
Hopefully not, because that could, yeah. That's some zoonosis. Yeah, from there we skinned it and then we disarticulated it and removed the limbs and skeletonized it in a colony of flesh-eating beetles.
Yeah, because you can't carve the flesh off as effectively as the beetles can eat it off the
bones.
Right,
yeah.
And you YouTubed this.
We did, yeah. We put it on YouTube. And from there, like it got quite a bit of attention. Roadkill wolf is the reason I have the job I do today.
Welcome to the Brain Scoop's new office. Isn't it cool?
Picking up on your life's trajectory, the Field Museum is one of the world's great collections of natural history artifacts. So your platform is much greater there, presumably.
Right, yeah.
In terms of funding, resources.
For a creative person like me, it's the best.
So I have my own hypotheses on this, but I like comparing notes. Where do kids lose their curiosity? Because we agree all kids have curiosity and not all adults have curiosity. So somewhere in there, there's like a leaky pipeline.
As soon as they start doing standardized testing.
Ooh.
Well, that's what it was for
Blood
me.
Drawn. It was blood drawn.
We stopped doing experiments in class. We stopped going on field trips, and instead you spent your time preparing for a test. For a test for information that you had no context for. And that for me is like where I lost my interest in biology and the natural world, because it all was distilled to diagrams and terms that I had to memorize.
There was no passion.
Right, yeah, and it wasn't being fostered by anyone. And so in terms of like what our goal for the program is, I just want people to take a longer look at the world around them. Turn over that rock, see what's living under it. Yeah, I think that's just the fascinating thing about curiosity is that it's self-perpetuating.
Would you say this is the future of science education?
YouTube?
Well, just what you're doing.
The technology has kind of misled people in terms of what we know and what we don't know, right? Like, they know that we have a rover on Mars, they know that we have satellites at the edge of the solar system. So to tell somebody that we only know 15% of all life that has ever lived on the planet, I think people just don't believe you. They're like, we know birds, we know mammals, what else is there? And so being able to show the kind of work that museums do, that natural history collections do, I do see that as the future for how these museums will connect with the public. If you want to talk about future and futuristic things, I think we all think of things like time machines. But museums serve that purpose. Museums are time machines. Museums and the collections are the only evidence we have to be able to look and evaluate what a habitat would have looked like. And that is only going to become more important as technology increases. It's like, we didn't know what genomics was 30 years ago. This is a brand new thing.
It's not even a thing. Yeah.
Yeah, it didn't even exist. So imagine what technologies we're gonna have in another 10 or 15 or 500 years, and how you can employ that to look at these specimens in the collection.
So let me hit the tennis ball back to you. Okay. You're the one cutting open the wolf, not I. So is it still working for me watching you do it? Am I still the explorer? Or has the technology made only some of us the explorer and the rest of us do it vicariously and maybe that's not as interesting?
I don't know. Because I'm not the audience member on that exchange, but what I hope it does is, right there.
Okay, but should the museum put their collection up on the web and so that you don't never have to leave your couch? Or should programs like yours stimulate people to get off their couch?
I want people to get off the couch. I want them to go to museums.
And I like
want
the couch.
Well, a couch is comfy, but the couch will still be there. You know, there's inquiry out there. There's adventure.
So you're hoping that I'm on the couch watching you cut open a wolf, and I say, that is awesome. Mm-hmm. So I get off the couch and visit my nearby museum.
Yeah.
And not substitute that live experience with technological displays of things.
Yeah, we can show you pictures of dioramas, we can show you videos of lions, we can show you any of these things, but museums are still the only place you can see that for yourself in person. Their importance only increases every second of every single day. We have within our collections specimens and artifacts and recreated habitats that no longer exist anywhere else.
Because they're gone. We overran them.
Yeah.
I didn't appreciate that until my first visit to South Africa. I'm there and there's like a watering hole there. And I'm looking at this, I'm thinking, it looked exactly like one of the dioramas at the American Museum of Natural History.
Yeah.
But it went directly into my deepest memories as a kid.
Man, the details they go to in those dioramas.
But I think it's a lost art. I don't know, do they still make dioramas?
We did, at the museum. We, through the Brain Scoop, we crowdfunded to build the first full-scale diorama in 60 years.
Right, because it's not a thing, right?
Right.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
So a diorama of what?
Striped hyenas. The director of exhibitions told me, like, you know, we have one diorama alcove that was never finished. In the 30s, they just kind of boarded it up and moved on. And so I said, we have this program, the Brain Scoop, which is meant to get people excited about natural history museums. So why don't we get them to help us build this? Why don't we get our audience to help us finish this?
You didn't even have to write a grant proposal.
No, we didn't. We just had to ask people and get them excited about it. Think about how cool it would be if all natural history museums, if the AMNH had a chief curiosity correspondent.
I'm going to put in the call today.
You are a chief curiosity correspondent.
No, but I don't know.
You don't think so?
You know what it is? I think the universe is inherently a fun place to be curious about, and I just sort of point people in that direction. If I saw a wolf, I would not think to myself, gee, I wonder what that looks like without skin. That's just not a thought that I have. So I need somebody who's in there to take my brain places I never thought to go. So I think there's no end to this.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.